last time, did we? We did not. So inshallah we'll do the Surah Al-Humaza today, and then we'll move further to go back in the sequence we have there in the tafsir. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina Hussein, sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma sahla lama jantu sahla tajala hazna wa sahla lama shayta sahla ya Rabbi Allahumma ameen. So last time we were about to explore three surahs all together because they're connected in a way. And those are the surah At-Takathur, and then Al-Asr and Al-Humaza. And I think we managed to finish At-Takathur and Al-Asr, but we haven't finished yet At-Takathur, Al-Humaza. A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. ويل لكل همزة لمزة الذي جمع مالا وعدده يحسب أن ماله أخلده كلا لينبذن في الحطمة وما أدراك ما الحطمة نار الله الموقدة التي تطلع على الأفئدة إنها عليهم مؤصدة في عمد ممددة. Now, as I said in the previous verse, that these three surahs, At-Takathur, Al-Asr, and Al-Humaza, are connected in a way in the meanings of the in the values that are delivered in these three surahs. At-Takathur warns us not to be fooled by the dunya and to wait until the last minute when we go to the cemeteries, whether for burial or for burying someone who's loved. And Al-Asr comes after that to give us an awareness that Allah Azza wa Jal made an oath by the value of the time, which is an important component of our life, and we are basically nothing but counted minutes and seconds, that once a day is gone, then part of us is gone, as Hasan al-Basri indicated. And then comes after that Surah Al-Humaza, in which Allah Azza wa Jal starts the chapter by giving a warning, wail. Wail, as it is indicated in the tafsir, whether it is an article of cursing someone or warning someone, or whether it is a valley in the hellfire wal iyadu billah that Allah prepared to those who deserve it, and one of them would be the people who apply or who are engaged in the actions to come in this surah. So, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Humaza and Lumaza. Two words are close in their pronunciation to each other. And the linguistic meaning of these two words, الهمز, الهماز, is الَّذِي يَغْتَابَ النَّاسُ وَيَطْعَنْ فِي أَعْرَاضِهِمْ. And وَاللُّمَزَ الَّذِي يُعِيبُ النَّاسُ وَيَنَالْ مِنْهُمْ بِالْحِجَابُ وَالْعَيْنِ. Both of these two words, as I said, are close in their pronunciation, and they're also close in their meanings. The first one, هُمَزَ, is the one who backbite, who talks about people behind their back, who attacks people when they're not present. And اللُّمَزَ is the one who would be also mocking people by using gestures. So Allah Azza wa Jal is warning people from engaging of all the actions that would be creating fitna and problems and feelings of hatred among people in the society. So Allah Azza wa Jal is saying, be careful. Do not be from those who are hamazin, yahmaz. And if you were the humaza comes from hams, close to the verb hams, which is whispering. And this is what normally would be the case with those who backbite people around them. They backbite them not in their face but behind their back, or they probably would be whispering and talking privately with other individuals when the person attacked is not present. So these are ill actions that Allah Azza wa Jal warns us not to be engaging in. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Again, they are not only you know, verbally attacking people behind their back, but also they would be using gestures and their talk and without making the person be aware of it, or belittling individuals around them by giving these gestures. We see that sometimes, you know, when people are, you know, trying to belittle others around them, especially those who have arrogance, they would be looking at people down and giving, you know, face gestures to indicate that to belittle others and humiliate them around them. So these are qualities that Allah Azza wa Jal have forbid and warned us not to be engaging in. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. And then after that, Allah Azza wa Jal goes on to illustrate further what are the qualifications of those who deserve the wail, the valley of the hellfire, which, as we said, you know, as one of the meanings of wail. الَّذِي جَمَعَ مَالًا وَعَدَّدَ. The one who have gathered the money and counted. يَحْسَبُ أَنَّ مَالَهُ أَخْلَدَ. Now, when you look into the, you know, the sequence of the ayat, or the words in these two verses, you will find that there's like a thread of certain actions that in characteristics or individuals that would qualify them to be, you know, from the hellfire and make them not decent individuals. First of all, attacking, belittling, arrogance, you know, humiliating others around them. Second, you know, vicious, their love to money is beyond normal, the norm. Allah Azza wa Jalla is showing us or portraying for us an image of a person who's so arrogant, who's got nothing but to always attack people and belittling them, and so arrogant. And yet at the same time, his arrogance is so vicious that he's so greedy that he loves money. Not only he loves them, that he continue to, you know, spend his life on collecting money, but he has the joy of always looking at the money and watching and counting over and over again. جَمَعَ مَالًا وَعَدَّدَ. You know, as if he is on a daily basis going back to his account or to where he saves the money and recount this as if this brings joy and pleasure to his ill, you know, nafs. So you could see, you know, the thread, the connection between those, this personality that Allah Azza wa Jalla portrays to us in this very short chapter and warns us not to be from them. Now, whether this ayah have came into talk about Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, the father of Khalid ibn Walid, the one who was one of the tyrants or arrogant people of Quraysh, who have knew the haq and avoided it, or whether it came in general terms, and this is what the Quran talks about terms and describe conditions, so that, you know, this ayah did not come to describe only certain individuals at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but came to warn people at all times, so that whether it is in the time, you know, early time of Islam, or it's in the mid time of Islam, or at the present time, we need not to be from those who are, you know, having these characteristics. But here we need to be a little careful about the issue of jama'a malan wa addada. Now, is there anything wrong of, you know, earning money? We talked about it in the previous, you know, halaqa, when we talked about earning money. There is nothing wrong by being successful and earning money. There's actually everything good about it. As when we look into those who were promised al-Jannah in their life, the majority of them had earned promise as a result of their spending in the cause of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Among them was Uthman ibn Affan, ما ضر عثمان ما صنع بعد اليوم. Among them, عبد الرحمن ibn Auf. As Aisha radiallahu anha said, يدخل الجنة عبد الرحمن بن عوف حبوا. And then when he inquired why, and she said, you know, if you do not spend much in the cause of Allah, and he gave up all the caravan in a difficult time in Medina. And many others who have demonstrated how the earning and spending in the cause of Allah Azza wa Jal is a very honorable ibadah. نعمل ما هو الصالح للرجل الصالح. You know, the good is the halal money to the halal to the good person who spends it and utilizes it in the right way. So Allah Azza wa Jal is warning us from falling into those into this category of having the money to be an issue for us to live for that would turn us to greedy and savage individuals whose main interest only to be having the joy of collecting money and counting them over and over again to feel that you know this is satisfying their inner you know drive of arrogance. الذي جمع مالا وعدده يحسب أن ماله أخلده. Why does this individual or these people of this you know ill feelings always so keen to collect money and count them over and over again? يحسب أن ماله أخلده, thinks that his money will make him live eternally. أخلده from خلود eternally, and whether it is by believing that money would give him good life, whether by believing that money would help him to be able to get better health care, whether it is money could help him to build a legacy that could you know continue to you know be remembered afterwards, because money is indeed an item that could you know help people to live decent life. And if you look even you know into the you know into you know our like you know in reality nowadays where we have you know countries of universal healthcare as they call it or advanced healthcare in their you know countries, people seem to be living for longer. You know, life is average living of individuals in these countries seem to be higher than those who do not have the same healthcare. So this is in the standard of a human being is possible. And at the same time, we know that those individuals who have accumulated wealth and became recognized and known as so many individuals that our children even are aware of them, their name is remembered, Khalid, recognized throughout the time, but it's not gonna be for that long. It will be for a short time that they will be recognized, or as a result of their quote unquote good work for humanity. Because now we know that there are those who spend using their money or the money they have earned, they use it in good causes, quote unquote. Now, what is it for them from that spending, from those who do not believe in spending for the cause of Allah Azza wa Jal? The rewards will be in the dunya, not in the akhirah. You know, those who and those who spend their money believing in Allah Azza wa Jal and the rewards of the hereafter, their rewards will be both in the dunya as well as in the akhirah. Earlier today we were talking about a hadith of how you know and when they fetus in the womb of the mother, Allah will, you know, sending the angel down to give the ruh, to soul the ruh in that in fetus and determine, you know, the time he lives or she lives and their provision and happiness or unhappiness and, you know, and the, you know, their, you know, qadr and until the rest of their life. And we're talking about how Allah Azza wa Jal could be blessing you in your time and in your in the beautiful provision to be able to do a lot in the time that Allah Azza wa Jal have allocated for you to be living in this dunya. And also at the same time, من صرّه أن يبسط الله له في رزقه وينسى له في عمره فليصب رحمه. There are good deeds that we do that will indeed provide and prolong or bless the time we have in our life, which is Salat al-Arham or the Sadaqah. Sadaqah is also another powerful tool of blessing or increasing the umr and increasing the provision. According as I said, this is a debate on the show among scholars whether the umr itself increases or whether Allah Azza will give you the barakah in your umr to be able to achieve more. Both meanings are also good in the context of what we're talking about in this surah. يحسب أن ماله أخلده. He thinks that this his money is going to make him eternally living or eternally remembered. And again, there is nothing wrong with earning the money in halal and spending the money in halal so that you are able to make your way to Allah to be from the Muhsineen. Kalla, Allah said, nay, that's not true. That's not the case. You know, so that our focus would not be in this dunya on making as much money as possible. When you ask, you know, people in certain societies, what's the definition of time? They say, or life, life is money, or time is money. They say time is money. This is not how they say it. Time is money. No, we look at time in different perspective and money at also in a different perspective. Kalla, that's not true. This is not the case. La yunbadanna fil hutama, he will be thrown into al hutama as a result of his actions, of his greed actions. We said again, being humaza, lumaza, and greedy in his collection for the money, attacking people, mocking people, backbiting people, and being so greedy into, you know, looking for money and earning money. Allah is saying, nay, that's not the case. His reward as a result of what he have done or she has done in this life of the wrong things that are, you know, presented will be to be thrown in Al-Hutama. Now, Allah Azza wa Jal wants us also again to know what's Al-Hutama. Al-Hutama is not an, you know, an Arabic word at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, but there were so many vocabularies that are introduced to the Arabic language from the Quranic, you know, text that have enriched the Arabic language. So Allah Azza wa Jal is saying he will be thrown into Al-Hutama. And then, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَمَ الْحُطَمَا. And then what would make you know what's Al-Hutama? نَارُ اللَّهِ الْمُوْقَدَ. And the answer comes that it is the blazing fire of Allah Azza wa Jal, that is the fueled blazing fire of Allah Azza wa Jal. Here Allah Azza wa Jal saying, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْحُطَمَا. What would make you know what's Al-Hutama? Well, you know, so that you'd start imagining and wondering, what is Al-Hutama? What Hutama is from tahtim, from breaking. And what does that have to do with the consequences of this individual or that person who's doing these actions in his or her life? And then eventually the answer comes to illustrate for you. Now, it's a blazing, it's a fire. Now, and it is the fire of Allah. Not of the people in this dunya. And so you can get off an idea of how painful this and severe and burning this fire would be. Narullah al-Muqada, it is already fueled and ignited and burning. Allati tattali'u ala al-afida, that will be reaching from its, you know, power and ability not only to the outer, you know, parts of the body, but would be reaching to the heart of the individual and burn it. But التي تطلع على الأفئدة إنها عليهم مقصدة. This fire is indeed is مقصدة. مقصد means locked in. So imagine that, you know, someone is locked into a space where they have no ability to escape or to run away from, and they are surrounded by وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ blazing fire, a burning fire, a huge fire. Just like, you know, unfortunately, if you were, you know, listening to the news, they were saying that the burning fire in the Tower of London, where many, you know, people got killed, they said they were as a result of wrong, policies of keeping, you know, the doors locked, because they thought this is going to help to prevent the fire from spreading around. But it was unfortunately what may have caused majority of those who were trapped in the tower to die as a result of the smoke and the fire. So imagine, as Allah is saying to us, that the punishment would be for these individuals or those, you know, people who are doing and who are living these categories in their life, is to be locked into narun muqsada in fi amadin mumaddada. Amad, it's from amud. Amud is a beam, whether it is long extended, beams to indicate how spacious and huge these locked in chambers of fire that they will be locked in, or whether it is beams or posts that these individuals will be chained on, so that they are going to be, unable to help themselves and avoid or run away from the torment that is surrounding them. So this is, a very ugly result to an ugly actions in this dunya. So if you look into the three surahs, you will find the connection between the surah At-Takathur al-Asr and Al-Humazah. May Allah Azza wa Jal protect us and help us to be from those who are guarding to their tongue. وَهَلْ يُكَبُّ النَّاسُ عَلَى مَنَاخِيرِهِمْ أَوْ عَلَى وُجُوهِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَادِ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. When Mu'adh radiallahu anhu asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, surprisingly, are we accountable for what we say, Rasulullah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wants to, teach Mu'adh so that the Ummah will be taught afterwards of how severe the consequences of unleashing your tongue. This tongue, this piece of meat that you have inside your mouth, is a very powerful, tool that could be determined to you to throw you in the hellfire, wa'iyadu billah, but also could be a tool that makes you from those who will be earning, the love of Allah Azza wa Jal, as the Prophet indicated, that a person will be saying a word, لا يقي لها بالاً, does not pay attention to the consequences of that word. من غضب الله, from the anger of Allah Azza wa Jal, will be throwing him into the hellfire, that long of time. And vice versa, a person will be saying a beautiful word into the pleasing of Allah Azza wa Jal, the intention of pleasing Allah Azza wa Jal, لا يقي لها بالاً, would not pay attention to its consequences, because he's used to do good all the time, and he's always in love into engaging into, da'wah to the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, and saying beautiful words of encouragement and support to people around him or her. As a result of that beautiful word of encouragement, of support, of kindness, Allah Azza wa Jal will be giving as a result for you al-Jannah. How many times we come across individuals who are heartbroken, who are, devastated as a result of difficulty they go through in their life, and then you come to them, and because you're used to be a person of kindness, a person of love, a person of support, a person who believes that مَنْ فَرَّجَ عَنْ مُؤْمِنٍ كُرْبَةً فَرَّجَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهَا كُرْبَةً مِنْ كُرَبِ الْجَنَّةِ, whoever alleviates for a person a suffering, Allah Azza wa Jalla alleviate for him a suffering of the sufferings of the hereafter, then you don't pay attention, much attention to it, because you do it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, not waiting for the rewards of this dunya. That word of support or encouragement would be perceived by that individual as the person who's in the desert, lost, has run out of water, and all of a sudden sees a glass of water coming to him, from nowhere, to quench the thirst in this difficult time. This what would be sometimes the consequences of the word of or the beautiful word, مثل كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة. So pay attention to the words you say from, your mouth. You're accountable. مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. You do not utter a word except that this word will be recorded to you. Even, if the words are meaningless, even if the words have, no values, everything will be recorded. We have guarding, angels who are protecting, but also they're writing everything down. So make sure that nothing comes from this mouth except something that you will be happy to see it in the time when you meet Allah Azza wa Jalla in the hereafter. مَا يَلْفُظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. So the Prophet ﷺ said to Mu'adh in a teasing way, ثَكَلَتْكِ أُمُّكَ يَا مُعَادْ, may your mother lose you, يَا مُعَادْ. وَهَلْ يُكَبُّ النَّاسُ عَلَى مَنَخِيرِمْ أَوْ عَلَى وُجُهُمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدِ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. Would not be people be thrown into the fire on their faces, or they're dragged on the fire but on their noses, except as a result of their their words or what they utter in this dunya. So this is an important thing that we need to be aware of. If you need to say something to an individual, if you feel that someone is doing something wrong, there are ways to do it. There are ways by approaching these individuals privately, and talk to them in a beautiful, you know, manner to advise them. You know, Allah Azza wa Jal, when He sent Musa alayhi salam to one of the most aggressive tyrants in history of mankind, Fir'aun la'natullahi alayhi, you know, he advised him, you know, قل له قولا لينا, you know, speak to him kindly and softly, so that Allah maybe, you know, will soften his heart and open his mind. So be, you know, if this is what Allah Azza advised His Prophet to when he sent him to communicate with Fir'aun. So the person whom you believe in your own perception is in a wrong position or stand is not even close to Fir'aun. Is not even, you know, have not even done that much, you know, compared to this tyrant, to this taghiyah. Yet the way to advise is to be gentle and kind and soft, with the intention that you're approaching them to advise them for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, for no other sake, not for the sake of your own nafs or hadd al-nafs, or for the revenging, or for, you know, proving them wrong and proving yourself right, or to do it in a public where you gain points in public as a result of being, you know, a learned person and putting them down. This is not how we advise each other, and this is not what we do in Islam. We our aim is to always, you know, maintain this connectivity between the different members of the ummah, of the community, and create this harmony and create this, you know, connection, كَسْكَنْ بُلْيَانِ الْمَرْصُوصِ, like the brick of the wall, connected with each other and feel each other, so we are strong in our, you know, and facing the challenges of this dunya and the life. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us from those who are inshallah able to guard themselves and their tongues. So probably could stop here now.